Hey guys, my name is Byfear. This is Outriders. Square Enix was kind enough to fly me out to Warsaw, where I was able to get about 6 hours of time with this upcoming game. They also let me capture almost all of that time, so I could show you more about what the game is and what to expect. Big thanks to the guys and gals at Square for making this happen. A brief description of the game before we start, because this is a little different, just so that you guys have a bit of an idea of what you're getting yourselves into. Outriders is a third-person action RPG created by People Can Fly, who were the creators of previous great shooters such as Painkiller and Bulletstorm, and if you've not heard of either of those, go back and find a copy and play them, particularly Painkiller. It's fantastic for what it was at its time. Co-op is a big focus of the game, but from what I've played, you could easily play it solo, and I don't think it would be discouraged. People have compared this to a mishmash between Destiny and Gears of War, and I'd like to say that I think they're completely wrong. They are muddying the waters there by even bringing Destiny into it, and so I feel like a much better comparison with this is probably going to be between something like, say, Diablo and Mass Effect. The combat and powers most certainly do feel like Mass Effect in terms of their variety. It is a deeper RPG system than you might be expecting from something like, say, Destiny. But by that same token, if you take a look into the gear, it will be a lot more like Diablo in terms of its depth. When you get to the later stages and you're getting your epic pieces of gear, it's going to change the way that you play your particular class and how your abilities get used. So no, I don't think a comparison to any of those games, like Destiny, are completely correct. Maybe the Gears of War one in terms of the combat, but even then I feel like Mass Effect, by the time you look at Mass Effect 3, is just more representative of it. There's also, as far as I can tell, no competitive multiplayer, which means they have the freedom to go crazy with the designs of all the gear that they're using, unlike Destiny. Having said that, the fact that it's a gear-based game may appeal to you, and considering that there's no persistent online multiplayer, and that this is a story-driven RPG, you might find something here for you. The game is built around hubs, world areas, side quests, regions, bosses, world tiers, etc., and it's all part of the game's landscape of activities that you have to do. Personally, while playing the game, I had fun. The abilities that you get to use are fantastic for the pure spectacle of them, and they're also very practical to be used either by themselves or in combination with the whole team. They really are the star of the show. In addition, I should say that the game felt really polished. In about 6 hours of playing, I didn't feel too much go wrong at all. There was no screen tearing, no FPS drop that I could notice, meaning the game was persistently running at or above 60 FPS. A total of one bug, which didn't break the game and was so minor that I've actually forgotten what it was. It was barely anything to do with gameplay experience. I think it might have been like an enemy clipping through a wall momentarily before teleporting away. So I'm not sure, but even so, it's very minor. The game did feel great to play, and we're still about 10 months out from release, and they're not done with all the parts of the game. For example, there are three classes at current, the fourth class and the later game content are still in development. They're not done with all the parts of the game, but this vertical slice, which was basically the beginning, which I was set loose within, was really quite promising. Now, admittedly, time will tell to see whether the rest of the game is like that, but let's just say that this was definitely not like playing a bad beta a few weeks before a game's release. This was a good experience, and I was really happy to play with it. This was not something that felt like a marketing beta. Everything that I played thus far did feel polished. All that said, let's get to the real meat of what you guys are probably here for, which is the story. The game plays with a lot of really powerful ideas about our own imperfection as human beings, the threat of extinction and potentially transcendence and what it means to be human. I think if I'm going to jump into any of these, I should probably just start from the top and tell you how the game begins. Oh, and by the way, yeah, just in case you were wondering, huge spoiler warning right now. If you wanted any details on the story to be kept quiet, yeah, this is the point at which you turn off, knowing only the basic themes. But regardless, let's continue. By the early 2030s, Earth is experiencing some unprecedented levels of disruption in the form of natural disasters. Earthquakes and seismic activity in particular are starting to literally tear the planet apart. There's speculation that this was caused by the underground testing of a new superweapon by the world's leading powers. In the end, the consensus is given that the globe won't last till the end of the century and that all life on Earth, including humans, will go extinct in the coming apocalypse. This was eventually revealed to the world in 2048, and anarchy soon started to engulf the planet, with humanity beginning to consume itself from the inside out. But by this point, they were already in trouble. Seismic events were killing hundreds of thousands, and all hell was already starting to break loose. This merely hastened the coming madness. It's at this point that the G9, sort of the G7 of this timeline, come together and start an initiative known as the ECA, or Earth Colonization Authority, which is basically a collection of the former heads of state and CEOs coming together to try and save humanity. They pooled their resources and began the construction of the Flores and the Caravel. These two ships would venture out beyond Earth using a recently discovered propulsion system that would accelerate them to 15% of the speed of light. This would allow humanity to find a new home. The Caravel, the scouting ship, would go first, leading on and finding a decent landing site for humanity ahead of the larger Flores, the Ark ship that was actually bringing the majority of humans frozen in cryo. The planet that was chosen as the likely best subject for colonization was a world dubbed Enoch. The craft were scheduled to take off in the mid-2070s, but due to catastrophic engine failure at launch, the Caravel never left Earth's orbit. By 2091, the final message from Earth is received by the Flores, and the rest of humanity is presumed extinct. This is the first point at which the game really puts the idea of leave humanity behind into context. Billions of people were left to die back on Earth. The Ark ship is huge, but it holds the last surviving vestige of humanity. There are only 500,000 people aboard the Flores, and that number is going to stick in your head. This gives you a real sense of the stakes in Outriders. I've played other games that have depicted apocalyptic scenarios, but this one hit me differently at the opening. It's very Mad Max with its visuals when you get into the actual game itself, but instead of being closer to a culture that a lot of people might glorify simply for how outlandish it is, I think this strikes me as genuinely horrifying, and not because there's some great barbarity on display, although there is, but simply because of the sheer dread behind it all. Those first 30 minutes for me were basically a prologue that helped push the point home that this was all that was left of humanity. Some estimations on the idea of a minimum viable population state that you need at least 3 million people in order to make sure that you can reproduce with enough genetic diversity. So 500,000 people on the Flores even seems small in that measure. There is unquestionably a certain amount of humanity that has been lost. And all of that really hits home when you sit there and things go wrong on Enoch. I know that there's replayable side quests and missions that will just throw waves of enemies at you, and you can't help but think, at least on the first time doing these, that every single one of those is a number lost off the count of 500,000, and every single time I take a shot, I'm counting down. Now, of course, those are replayable missions, so I sit there and think to myself, well, yeah, okay, because video game. But I still never really kicked that feeling in the first few minutes of play. I sat there and thought to myself, I am ending entire generations here simply by killing one person, and that's both really powerful and really terrifying. But again, all of this is getting kind of ahead of myself, so yeah, bear with me, we'll get back to this idea later, and how it changes. When arriving on Enoch, the Flores sends down probes to find data on the planet from its atmosphere to the levels of radiation and contaminants in the air. These probes are the first indicators of whether Enoch is a viable world. The reality of it is, however, that the survivors don't really have much of a choice. With the Caravel destroyed, their scout capabilities are completely decimated, and if Enoch isn't a viable world, then nowhere will be. The probes were swiftly followed down to the surface by the Outriders. Think of Outriders as sort of the last surviving soldier explorers of Earth. They're armed to the teeth due to the fact that we clearly don't know what we're going to find on Enoch, but they also have the specific purpose of ensuring that Enoch was suitable for settlement by humanity and being the metaphorical first wave. It's their job to go and retrieve the probes and send their data so that the assessments for safely landing on this planet can be made. You are one such Outrider, and your first real mission is to go out and retrieve the data of a fallen probe that's fallen beyond the perimeter of most others. That's when you encounter something that changes everything, something only known as the anomaly. The game's codex sums up the anomaly as a poorly explained phenomenon that creates a zone known as a storm. The storms distort the laws of physics within their bounds, making things like gravity, the arrangement of atoms, and even time itself unreliable. Most people caught in the storm are simply consumed. When the Outriders encounter this, they take heavy losses and retreat to their drop pod. They're almost all put back into cryogenic suspension until medical assistance can be administered. This assistance never comes, and you spend roughly 30 years sleeping in cryogenic suspension. When you wake up, you get thrown straight into the fire, namely into no man's land. In the 30 years since you've been put into cryo, humanity landed and has been split by the lack of resources and by being enclosed on all sides by the storm. Now this valley harbors the last of humanity, and they're split into two warring factions. To the north lie the insurgents, and on the other side are the ECA. But the problem here comes not just from the war itself or the shortage of resources or the imminent disaster that will happen if the storm encroaches upon them all. There's all the gruesome side effects that this has if you live in the trenches of no man's land, if you live in the insurgents' camps, or if you happen to find yourself in the squalor of the ECA holdings. It's not uncommon to hear people screaming in some of the hub areas that they haven't eaten in days, and you also hear lines about how the insurgents literally eat their own children to survive. Another effect of the storm is that all of humanity's technology is rendered useless, meaning that anything more complex than a dirty old petrol engine isn't going to work. Electronics, the ability to create houses from 3D printers, anything that would have helped with colonization died with the storm. And now there's something even worse. Because of the fact that they also used electronics, all of the solutions required to grow crops were lost as well. Now humanity is fighting over what little they have left, and what little they have left is almost nothing. The ECA and the insurgents have been fighting a massive trench war that constantly shifts the boundaries of where their territories lie for years now. And it feels, in themes at least, something closer to the Great War of 1910, rather than the futuristic one that you might expect out of the near 22nd century. These weapons are more advanced, albeit rusted. Everything is almost completely broken down, and this is where the real theme of the game lies. It's here again that I think I need to circle back to the idea of leaving humanity behind, except this time, instead of a literal sense, I think it's much more metaphorical. It's more of a look upon our cruelty and ask what it is to truly be human. Are we still thus? Kind of way of saying things. It's hitting home with some pretty clear questions from the very beginning, but how those questions are posed to us is something that I can't really tell from the snippet of the game that I've seen. I would doubt that there wouldn't be some kind of morally challenging moment that really makes us ask what it is to be human, that really makes us sit there and think, well, is this such a barbarous act that it goes beyond humanity? And perhaps a moment where we sit there and see the other side and realize, well, maybe humanity is not so terrible. Maybe there is good in all of us intrinsically. Thus far, there are no big ticket moments in the story that I saw, at least for now. And that's fair because this first area that I played in is really much more about establishing the world and setting the stage. It's completely okay. I would hope to see this theme expanded upon later in the future, and I would be surprised if it somehow didn't come up again. However, the truly outlandish side of Outriders is what's about to completely flip this slogan of leave humanity behind on its head, and is going to bring it back to a much more literal meaning, but beyond just that, is also going to make you really think. And I think this all comes from the storm and the powers and the altered. Remember how I said that most of the Outriders died in the storm? Well, they aren't all of the Outriders. Some people did in fact survive. They in fact survived direct exposure. and for those who actually managed to survive direct exposure, an entirely new life awaits them. After spending 30 years in cryogenic suspension, many of them now come out with powerful new abilities, and the world around them refers to them as the Altered. But they aren't the only Altered in the world, and are always seen as powerful beings because they always do have powers that defy explanation. Some people even worship you as if you're a god, some people give you clear reverence and deference, and some people view you with utter terror. Take a look at this scene, for example, where someone interrupts one of my interactions with a merchant, and then realizes that I'm an Altered.
What wonders I have for sale?
Another time, mister. I'm having one shitty day.
Bitter wind blows for us all. Come, how about a little hot tea?
Not much of an inventory.
Don't mind all this crap, money. I keep all the good stuff in.
Should have paid, old man! You're Altered. I didn't know.
Think I care?
He's about to show me the good stuff.
Just acting on orders.
Whose orders?
Barker, he runs the Hounds gang. He's trying to take out all the vendors in Rift Town. It won't work!
Now, the criminal there was totally fine with just murdering the old man, but the second he realizes that I'm Altered, he gives me all the respect in the world, gets on his knees, apologizes, and realizes that I'm a greater power because I am. You and other Alters have unique abilities, unique powers that render you easily capable of destroying other human beings on a whim. To give just a few examples, the Trickster can manipulate space and time to teleport or prevent projectile weapons from even reaching their targets. Bullet time and slowing enemy projectiles down is literally a power you get. The Devastator can crash into you like an avalanche and break bone like it's snapping their fingers. And Pyromancers can set you or your loved ones on fire without batting an eyelid or breaking a sweat. People die because of the Altered, and the world makes it really clear that they're seen as something more than human. At first, I was wrapped up in how this made me feel in the moment, and I needed to do some deeper observation to really understand where this came from. And the reason I say that is because at first, I thought this kind of broke the rest of the world for me. I was immersed in a gritty, gut-filled apocalypse, something with terrifying imagery, and that 500,000 number was stuck in my head. And that bugged me when I got my powers to a certain extent, because the powers kind of trivialized human life. I sat there and before I thought, well, this counter of 500,000 means that every death is a tragedy. Every single one of these people that is dying is truly a loss, and we can't afford to kill many of them. We really should try and take as non-combative a route as possible. And then I got my powers, and then everything changed. And suddenly, all that I knew was destruction. And at first, this really didn't hit me. The entire point of the game, after all, was supposed to be protecting humanity. You're an outrider. You're meant to find safe ground for them. And in the meantime, I have powers that literally allow me to turn people into skeletons before instantly jibbing them. This was something that bugged me a whole lot. And it was only when rewatching footage and looking again at the trailer that I really realized what was going on. And when I looked again at my footage, I found Seth once more. It's one of his conversations that really solidified what I was going to write for this video, and it made me realize that my focus in the very beginning, which made me feel like the powers trivialized the loss of human life, was actually kind of an obvious ploy by the game at a real question. Seth is another Altered, and it seems really clear that he's loosely aligned with the ECA and is out there helping humanity, sort of. You first meet him and his weird culty follower in this scene.
Altered. I could smell the storm in your blood, your stink of Enoch.
Your kind are abominations, exile.
Who the hell are you?
Outrider. Impossible. Such untapped power, such confusion. You want answers. Whatever you were before, you're something new now. A second life. Don't waste it.
Who was that?
Lord Zeth? He's altered. Hank is a little man. A little man.
Altered? What the fuck does that mean?
Zeth sees you and your raw power as a source of potential, and you fascinate him as one of the last surviving Outriders, as well as a fresh altered. This becomes relevant again in the second conversation you have with him later in the snippet of gameplay that I was able to get my hands on with. In this second scene, he states that there's clearly a fight beyond that of the ECA and the Insurgents, and this is what opened my eyes.
They asked you to help them, to fight the Alter down there. Why didn't you?
That pathetic monstrosity was a distraction.
People are dying because of him. Without the supply route open,
they all die. These feeble creatures. Slaughtering each other over scraps. You waste your gifts. Running errands for them. Trying to win that meaningless, endless war. You must realize, you are not like them anymore.
So what? I should play at being a god like you.
I am not playing.
But you are something even more. Altered and Outrider. The last Outrider. Do what you were sent here for. Go beyond the frontier.
These people need their gods. Only one like you could lead them to a future.
Why not you?
They call him Moloch.
I fight another war, far above this petty squalor. My war is with the worst of our kind. This one is too powerful. He will destroy us all, unless I hunt him down.
But this is not your fight. You are to be the shepherd. Find a way for them out of this slaughter, Outrider.
So Zeth is now hunting another Altered who is capable of destroying humanity and is a huge threat to us all. He's involved in the war between the Insurgents and the ECA, but only insofar as it allows him to hunt other Altered. Rewatching this scene was when it really struck me why Leave Humanity Behind truly was the best tagline for the game. Yes, it could mean how society has devolved, and yes, it could refer to the billions left to die on Earth. But I think the tagline actually refers to the much more present struggle within the player, which I believe is going to be at the heart of the story. In the trailer for Outriders, it talks about how the storm took so much from the Outriders and yet it gave them so much in return, and that deep within, following the signal of that original probe that was relaying its signal off of something else deeper in Enoch's reaches, there might be answers. And beyond just that, there is the bigger question here. As an Outrider and an Altered, and as the main character in this story, you have the potential to be the savior of humanity. But are you really human? You've sort of transcended them. You are in a lot of ways not human at all, and the way that the anomaly has changed you has changed others like you to not care about humanity at all. Altered are seen as different. Altered see humanity as less. Even Zeth, who tasks you with being a shepherd for mankind, doesn't really care for the imminent struggles of the ECA-aligned population. He treats all of the day-to-day concerns, the things that would potentially threaten them, as childish and trivial concerns. He does not care for them. He sees all of those concerns as lesser to his own agenda because he thinks and sees that humanity in its current state can't see parts of the bigger picture. he is able to see from a completely different perspective than the rest of us, and beyond just that, that is something that puts him aside from the rest of us as an altered. He is simply there with a different set of agendas, agendas that completely transcend the petty squabbles of the vast numbers of humanity. He's dealing with abilities that give him demigod-like power, and he's fighting others that also use their demigod-like power as if they were gods. And this is the struggle that concerns him. It is not a human struggle. It is a struggle between the altered. And that, I think, is one of the biggest narrative threads that I expect the game and the writing team to tug on the most. I want them to ask the simple question of, are you still human, and what makes you human when you have these altered abilities? I think they're going to really heavily pull on this idea at the core of the narrative. And so I wouldn't be surprised if the signal coming from deep in Enoch is something of an alien source. But beyond all of just that, that's speculation. Either way, no matter how you look at Outriders, the simple tagline that you need to remember is right there on the front: leave humanity behind. Although perhaps if you're looking into this more quizzically, leave humanity behind with a question mark. So yeah, that's sort of a breakdown of what's going on in Outriders from the first 6 hours worth of gameplay that I was able to see. And yeah, this is kind of my take on the humanity being left behind part. All this different dialogue about extinction and what it means to be human. I think it's really fascinating. And yeah, I hope this made a really good video for you all. I'm interested to see the response to something like this. It's a little bit different from what I normally do, but it was fun to make. I also loved what I played of the game so far, and I'm interested to see where it goes. If you are also interested in seeing where Outriders will find itself, consider following the channel. If you're interested in more content, then go ahead and let me know, and I'll see about covering more of the game as the game progresses. Also, for those of you that are watching, yes, this will absolutely be a T-Slape, and I cannot wait for Chromar to play as a Devastator. The game is still about 10 months out, so your thoughts in the comments section are very much appreciated. Any feedback that you're able to give on this might actually reach the devs in time to make it an actual change in the game. So yeah, that's pretty good actually. Beyond all of just that, again, I need to say thank you. If you enjoyed the video, go ahead and leave a like. Thank you so much for all of the support on a video like this. And thank you again to Square Enix for flying me out so that I could play the game. But as always, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Prodacia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.